good morning and welcome to worship. Certainly glad that you've decided to join us here this morning. Before we get started, if you would just take a minute or so to quiet your heart, bring yourself here this morning into God's presence and lay things at his feet so that we might be able to give him our whole heart, our whole mind, our whole body to worship this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this morning. Lord, we thank you for the chance to worship you, to gather together in your name, to offer you praise this morning. Lord, I'm reminded this morning of some of the sharing that we did as a worship team, that we all have things going on, things that bring us concern, bring us pain, bring us sorrow, worries that we have about the future. But Lord, we know that if we build our lives on a firm foundation of you, that we have nothing to fear, but only praise to give you for how gracious, how loving, how generous you've been to us. So we come before you this morning, Lord, with hearts desiring to praise you, hearts that are willing to praise you, and to give you our whole life and place it on the name of Jesus, who gave it all for us. It's in his precious and holy name that we pray. Amen. Well, would you stand with us and get ready to praise? Let's put our hands together too. I'll praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure, praise when I'm doubting. Praise is a weapon, it's more than a sound. My praise is the shout that brings Jericho down. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to pray. Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
sovereign. Praise cause you reign. Praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I praise cause you're faithful. Praise cause you're true. Praise cause there's nobody greater than you. I praise cause you're sovereign. Praise cause you reign. Praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I praise cause you're faithful. Praise cause you're true. Praise cause there's nobody greater than you. Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Take a moment to greet one another. Take a moment to greet one another, church.
I depend on you for the depend on you. I depend on you. Draw me close and teach me to abide. Be my strength, my song in the night. Be my all, my treasure, my prize. I am yours forever, you're mine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. We will overcome. by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony.
Service here on this earth, God. Thank you for sending your Son to die on the cross for our sins so that we could spend eternity praising you. But here we are this morning, Lord, offering our feeble praise to you to give you glory above all else. Lord, we give of our tithes and offerings as well so that you can continue to use that for your glory here and around the world. Lord, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the opportunity to lift songs of praise to you and to hear your word this morning preached to us. May we have fertile hearts ready to receive the word you have for us. It's in Jesus' powerful, precious, and mighty name that we pray. Amen. Would you be seated? And we're going to continue in our worship as our brother Joe plays a song for us.
Good morning. Hi, Molly. Okay, ladies, I need you to give me a whoop whoop. Can you do it again? Oh, that was weak. What do you think, Andrew? Yeah, okay, come on up, buddy. Ladies, come on, give me a whoop whoop. All right, ladies, we have something special on Saturday. This upcoming Saturday, the ladies' breakfast. Have you signed up yet? If you haven't, you scan that QR code right now. It's so fast. I did it while I was brushing my teeth this morning, not gonna lie. You scan that code or just click through the email. All you have to do is put your name, your phone number, maybe your email address, and how many people are gonna be attending. You do not have to commit to what you're bringing. That was good for me, because I can't make a decision that far in advance. So, sign up. It helps us know how many tables to set up. There's going to be great food. Say you wake up that morning and you're like, oh no, I don't have anything to prepare. I can't go. Foolishness. No, come anyways. You just come. There's always so much food, right? There's always so much food. So if you happen to have, you know, a stack of gum you can bring with for after all that food, that's a great idea. Otherwise, just bring yourself. That's really all we care about. So when is the ladies' breakfast? Saturday, like in 6 days. So I hope to see you there. It's at 9 a.m. and it will go till noon. All right, that's it about that announcement. Next announcement. You ready? I have my little helper, Andrew, here, because he's my youngest child, and we love kids camp, don't we? Yeah, so I'm sure nothing's happening behind us. Something's happening, he says. I don't see anything, but I'm getting ready for kids camp, you guys. I got my scuba gear. Oh, I'm on the lookout. I'm on the lookout for anything exciting happening. I don't know. Do you guys see anything happening? It's right there. Well, I'm just going to carry on with my announcements. So part of my scuba gear are these. You may be wondering, why do I need an empty 2-liter bottle? Oh, I know. Maybe it could be part of my scuba pack, right? Maybe even this direction, but, I don't know. I don't know what's going on. Here, can you hold my scuba gear? Hold my scuba gear. Oh, I don't know, kids. I don't know, kids. So I just wanted to bring up a few visuals for you. Here, Andrew, hold this one, too. Shark. There's a shark. Oh, my goodness. Okay, well, let's focus on this for a minute and show our friends what we have. Let's see. What do we have? We have 2 2-liter bottles. Has anyone ever done this motion before? Okay, I see some people giving me a visual. Good. Can you all pick up one of your hands and try and make this position and go, oh, so good. You can spray paint. Look at you. I was thinking maybe yellow, right? Some yellow spray painted things to be oxygen tanks. So if you can do this, which you all showed me you did, then we could use your help at one of our kids' camp days. Oh, I don't know what's going on back there. Okay, now, some of you say, I'm not very creative. That's okay, we've got projects for you. We have ideas for you, and we also know that you can do it. This is just a little lantern, right? Just imagine adding a few streamers to the bottom. And then it becomes a jellyfish. Isn't that cute? That's so cute. Okay, and then I have to brag on my friend Ashley. I could only bring a small one up. This is spray foam. You know that stuff, right? And then spray painted. You should see what she has created. It is epic. I love it. My favorite thing. Can you go like this? Yes, you can. So can you make something amazing like this? Yes, you can. And we will give you everything you need to succeed. Yes, honey. Oh my gosh, I don't see anything. I don't know what you're talking about. All right, now speaking of my dear friend Ashley, she has a daughter who I also adore. She has 2 daughters who I adore, and a son who I adore. But the daughter made this out of what? Can you tell what this is? Cupcake liners! Oh my gosh, how cute! On a skewer, right? And then we're going to have a whole bunch of them, stick them together to make coral. So I know I'm taking a lot of time to show you these. These projects, but I want you to see that with simple household objects, you can make something awesome, right? And all you need is a little bit of time. And we are here with, we got one more visual. Me and Andrew made these with coffee filters. You just put a little food coloring on a plate with water, and it soaks it right up. You don't even have to separate them. You could do it in chunks of like 20 coffee filters, and it soaks them all up. And then you open them up, put a pipe cleaner in them, and you just make these little coral bunches. And so that is one of the take-home projects that we have for you. All the directions, it's like 3 steps, but directions for you, everything you need in a bag out there. So if you're able to do something like this, maybe you could pick that up. If that is a little bit too creative for you, you're like, whoa, Jess, that's like, whoa. Let me show you something else. See this? Do you know what we needed people to do for this? Cut. Use some scissors. So if you know how to use some scissors, we have a project for you too back there. So please stop by back there and pick up something that you could just cut. That every little bit is so, 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 so helpful. I don't know what you're talking about, Andrew. I just also want to highlight one more super cool thing. We need lots of plastic bottles. Look at this. Andrew, hold one of those for me, babe. Thanks. And look at that. Look at this. This is made with Gatorade bottles. Isn't that cool? That is so cool. So if you're like, wow, how do they make these things? You know what? We have step-by-step directions for you. So come next time we have a decorating day. Be on the lookout. I am so good at looking out for things, right? I'm terrible at it. Okay, let me just highlight over here these dates. The next one, we had a day yesterday, so you missed that one, sorry. But next time we're meeting together as a group is Saturday, May 4th. That's so easy to remember, right? May the 4th be with you. You've seen that a million times, so it's going to be wormed in your head. May the 4th be with you. Come with us and decorate. It's so fun. We get a lot of work done, and it's fun to just chit-chat with other people in your community here at church. Who is that?
It's a shark.
Oh, my goodness. Okay, well, that's it for us. I guess we'll see you guys. Keep on the lookout.
Announcement as well as that shark is Sherman. Everyone say bye, Sherman. Sherman left. All right. All the children are now dismissed. Let's say goodbye to the children as they go off to kids ministry. But the junior hires will be staying in today, so please stay. And we're very excited as Jess announced, we have kids camp coming up next month. And as many of you know, kids camp is a huge outreach ministry for our church. And we have many, many children that come, especially from the local neighborhood, many children that don't know who the Lord is. And so we take this opportunity to share with them the love of Christ. And so we want to encourage everybody to please sign up and volunteer because we want to bless the local community. Can we hear amen to that? Amen, amen. All right. Another exciting announcement that we have today is one of our elders, Mark Smith, is going to be ordained into the ministry today this afternoon. And where is Mark? I don't see him. Oh, he's back there on security, making sure we're safe. Thank you, Mark. And his whole family is here as well. Beautiful family's here. So please, we welcome everyone to join us this afternoon at 1:30 p.m. for the ordination ceremony. We're very, very excited. Very excited. So if you have your Bibles with you this morning, please open to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Verses 10 through 17, and we welcome you all to our Lord's Day worship here at Jubilee Bible Church. We're so glad that you're here to worship with us. If you're new and visiting us for the first time, we've been walking through a sermon series on Paul's letter to the church in Corinth, and we've landed here in chapter 3, verses 10 through 17. And if you're taking notes, our sermon title this morning is Building My Life on Christ Alone. Building my life on Christ alone. If you don't have your Bibles, I've got the passage up here I'm going to read, and then we're going to pray and ask the Lord to speak to us this morning. The Word of God reads, according to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it. For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, and straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day, capital D, will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. Verse 14, if the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. Verse 16, do you not know that you are God's temple? Thank you, Lord, and that God's Spirit dwells in you. Verse 17, if anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is holy, and you are that temple. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to our God. Will you bow with me in prayer as we ask the Lord to speak to us through the power of his word this morning? Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your amazing grace. As we heard our brother Joe play on the harp, your amazing grace that has made wretched, hell-deserving sinners chosen in the Father's heart to become the most beloved children. God, we praise you for this gospel truth, that Christ has died and he has taken away our sins forever. God, if there is anyone joining us here this morning, anyone watching on YouTube that does not know you, if there's anyone who feels far from you, Father, we pray that today would be a day where there is a resolve, a decision to surrender to you, a decision to bend our knee to you, because you have come to give life and life to the full. And so, God, this morning, as we turn to your word, we pray that you would speak to us. As Jeremiah 15 said, your words were found and I ate them, and your words became in me the joy and delight of my heart. And so, God, we pray this morning that we would consume, we would delight in your word, and our hearts would be made full because of who you are. God, we love you so much. We thank you. We pray this all in Jesus' name, and all God's people say, amen, amen. Question: have you ever built something that will surely last longer than your life? Have you ever built something that will surely last longer than your life? You know, some of us have built our homes, which we would safely assume would last for decades. Some of us have built our businesses from scratch. Maybe when you were in junior high, you were in shop class and you made something. It's sitting in your parents' attic and it's stored there for all time. Some of us have built cars, computers, nice trust funds, social media accounts. Have you ever built something that will surely last longer than your life? You know, if you head to southern France, you'll meet a man by the name of Gerard Bryan. And Gerard Bryan spent 15 years of his life building a miniature version of Paris in his backyard. He started this project when he was 14 years old, and he finished the project when he was 29. He clocked in about 20,000 hours of handcrafting work using recycled materials, soup cans, baby food jars, other bits of waste that would usually be destined for the garbage. And with more than 100 bonsai trees in his backyard, he built more than 40 Paris monuments, including the Eiffel Tower, on a 1 to 130 scale. Incredible. In fact, you can tell by the pictures that the city is very realistic, down to the smallest details in his backyard. And his backyard in southern France has now become a major tourist attraction, with over 150,000 visitors a year. Imagine more than 400 people wanting to swing by your backyard to see this amazing creation. Incredible, isn't it? You know, you and I may not be working to build a model of downtown Chicago in our backyards, but I would propose that just like Gerard Bryan, all of us are laboring. Every one of us in this room, we are working hard to build something with our lives, are we not? And you know, that begs the question, is what I'm building, is what you're building going to outlast your earthly life? The prophetic words of Christ, Jesus from Revelation 22, that will be fulfilled sooner than later, Jesus Christ says this, "Behold, I am coming quickly." Can we hear amen to that? Christ is coming quickly. And Jesus says, "My reward is with me to reward each one as his work deserves." You know, one of the greatest motivating forces in the Apostle Paul's life was this very truth, that number one, Christ is coming back. And when Jesus comes back, number two, it's going to be a time of what? Receiving rewards. And Paul had this day in mind, and he was always preparing himself, you know, not because he wanted all kinds of glory and honor for himself, but because if he was going to work and labor to build something with his life, he's going to give his best. It's like running a race, as he said in 1 Corinthians 9. If he's going to run a race, he's not going to run just to pass or just to make it. No, he's going to run with one thing in mind, and that was what? Winning it. If he's going to fight in a fight, he's going to fight to win the match, because anything less than giving your best does not honor the Lord. And so this reward for the Christian life isn't so much a matter of earning some kind of prize or getting glory for myself, but it's about giving our best in all that we do, which brings honor to the God who gives us breath each day. Can we hear amen to that? And so as we continue in our text from last week, what is Paul going to show us today? He's going to show us this morning that there is coming a time. He's addressing Christians. Christians in the church, but there is a very special word for those who do not know the Lord as well. We'll get to that in a moment. But he's addressing believers. He's showing us that there's coming a time when all the work that you and I are doing as believers, all the labor is going to be tested by fire one day to determine, is it worthy of reward? And this becomes very important to Christians, so we not only prepare for that day, but what we consider is how do we build our lives in such a way so that we will not be ashamed when we stand before the Lord Jesus Christ one day. If you look at 2nd letter to Corinthians chapter 5, verses 9 through 10, this was the very motivation for why Paul was doing ministry. I mean, look what Paul writes. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him, Jesus Christ. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may receive what is due. There it is, reward. For what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. So friends, as believers, if you're a believer here this morning, we are working, we are laboring in order to be rewarded, for the judgment of Christ is coming. He's going to evaluate our work, and that should motivate us. Does that motivate you? Amen? Now, I want to remind you, as we look at the Bible talks a lot about judgment. Judgment. You know, this is talking about judgment on the believer's work. It's not talking about judgment on the unbeliever or those who don't know the Lord. As you look throughout the Bible, there's a lot of speaking of judgment. There's judgment of the nations in Matthew 25. There's judgment of Satan, judgment of Israel, judgment of sin, which was taken care of at the cross. Can we hear amen to that? Judgment of the unsaved. But in our text this morning, we are looking at the judgment of the believer's works. What you and I as believers have done with our lives. There's coming a day when Christians will be judged on what we've been working and investing our lives to build. You know, I'm sure for many of us, we've heard a lot of different stories, maybe even read books about, well, if you're a Christian today, what's it going to be like when you die and go to heaven? What's it going to be like when you die as a Christian? I think a common belief, a lot of people, I would call this the St. Peter at the gate, or St. Peter and the list. Some people believe this, where St. Peter's going to be standing at the pearly gates with a checklist, and if your good outweighs the bad, then he'll let you in. Can we turn to our neighbor and say, that is wrong? Other neighbor, that is completely wrong. Friends, this could not be further from the truth. St. Peter is worshiping God. He's not standing at the gate with a list. How do we know that? Philippians 3:20. If you've placed your faith in Christ, you are already a citizen of heaven. Can we hear hallelujah? And your faith has been sealed in Christ. And friends, that's why you and I, we have one life to live, one life to make a decision for Christ. Because when your time is up on this earth, there are no second chances. We don't pray for people who have already passed away. We have one life to make a decision. Another common belief is think of believers going to heaven. What's it going to be like? People say, well, believers will probably be judged or punished for all the sins that they committed after they were saved, or maybe sins they forgot to confess. Can we turn to our neighbor and say, absolutely not. All of our sins were paid for at the cross. And that's why the Bible says in Romans 8, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Later in chapter 8, it says, who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who is interceding for us. God has already declared us righteous if you've placed your faith in Christ. So question, what will judgment look like as a Christian? What will judgment look like when we get to heaven? Friends, it'll be a time of rewards. No condemnation, no punishment. How do we know that? If you look one chapter over in your Bible, in chapter 4 of 1 Corinthians, Paul says, therefore, judge nothing before the appointed time. Wait until the Lord comes, and he is coming soon. The Bible says he will bring to light what is hidden in darkness. He'll expose the motives of the heart. Here it is. At that time, each will receive what? Their praise from God. When Jesus comes, he will do what? What is every believer going to get? Are they going to get judgment? Are they going to get punishment? Are they going to get condemnation? The Bible says we will get praise from God. Every genuine, authentic believer in Christ will have praise from God. There won't be anyone condemned if you're a believer in Christ. No one is going to be shipped off to hell. Oops, your sins are too great. No, there will be no punishment because why? Jesus bore all the punishment for us. He died to take your sin and mine away. Can we hear amen to that? And so as we get into our text, the Apostle Paul is going to show us that all believers are building a building. We're building a building. And we're building a building out of certain materials. And there's coming a day where there's going to be a fiery test, and that fire is going to be applied to that building, and only what's left will be rewarded. And so as we look at our text, we're going to look at 4 points. Build. Turn to your neighbor and say, let's build. So what are we building? Well, let's build on the true foundation, and then we want to build with the best materials, because there are a variety of materials that you can build with. Let's build toward the final inspection, and then finally build God's dwelling place. First point is build on the true foundation, if you're taking notes. Look at just verse 10 with me as we look back at our text. Paul says, according to the grace of God given to me like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each take care how he builds upon it. As you look at the text, friends, why does Paul describe himself as a skilled master builder that laid a foundation? Why? Because Paul is a foundation guy. Let's turn to our neighbor. He's a foundation guy. What does that mean? Paul went around, and what did he do? He started churches. Paul started churches. If you look at Romans chapter 15, 20, what does it say? He didn't just go anywhere. What does the Bible say? Paul went where Christ was not being preached. It says what? And thus, Paul says, I make it my ambition to preach the gospel, not where Christ has already been named, lest I build on someone else's foundation. Paul wanted to go where Christ was not being preached. And so you know what Paul's strategy was? He would go into the town synagogue. He would win the Jews over to Christ. And then once he got some Jewish converts, he'd move into Gentile community, win them over to Christ. He'd establish a church grounded in the saving message of the gospel. That was his strategy and approach. And we find all throughout the book of Acts, and he was so skilled at doing this. In fact, when you look throughout the book of Acts, which actually spells out how all these churches came to be, in the city of Corinth, which is what we're looking at this morning, the letter, Corinthians, it took Paul 18 months to do that. About 18 months to set up the church. What about Ephesus? How long did it take Paul to set up the church in Ephesus? If you go to Acts 19, about 3 years in Ephesus to set up the church for Jesus Christ. What about Thessalonica? If you go a few chapters back, it took Paul less than a month to establish the church in Thessalonica, because the Spirit of God was doing a faster work there. What do we see? Wherever Paul went, in all those places, what was he doing? He was laying the foundation. And that was his job. Laying the foundation. I love what he acknowledges at the beginning of verse 10. He says, according to the grace of God given to me. The grace of God given to me. How was all this possible? How was all this possible? It was all through the grace of God, the amazing grace of God that he did not earn, but grace that was given. Can we hear amen to that? The same grace that's given to you and me all the days of our lives. You know, what's interesting is I was preparing this sermon over the past week, and on Tuesday afternoon, I was kind of thinking about, you know, according to the grace. God, like what? That's just a beautiful way for Paul to say this. Like, what does that mean? What does that mean? And in that moment, I don't know if Julie, is Julie Rowe here? Miss Julie? Maybe she's not here. But anyhow, Miss Julie Rowe, she randomly texted me a song. Like in that moment, she texted me a song called Grace. And if you're Korean, in Korean, grace is une. And so out of the blue, she texted me this song saying, hey, this is a beautiful song I heard. It's called Grace. I'm like, oh, okay. So I took a break from my sermon prepping and I just played the YouTube clip she sent me. And I started tearing and crying. And I'll tell you why in a moment, because I'm going to show you the lyrics, because I think this is what Paul would have sung. It's what Paul would have said. This is the lyrics of this song called Grace, if you want to look it up on YouTube. I know there's probably a lot of songs called Grace, but this is Grace by GCO Praise. But let me look at the lyrics of this song. It says, every blessing I have taken pleasure in, I wish I could sing it, but I can't. Every single moment I have ever spent, every single step I've taken in this life, oh, none of them I earned, all was by grace. The rising and the setting of the sun, the scent of flowers in spring, harvest and fall, every moment as each season passes by, it's simply not the course of time. It's all by grace. And the chorus goes like this, everything is your grace, your grace. Your grace, your unending grace. In my life, there's not a single thing I claim to have deserved. Everything is your grace. It was your grace. And I just started crying in front of my computer, listening to this song, and it happened to me as I was reading verse 10, when Paul says, according to the grace given to me. I think Paul, as we look at this passage, is not taking any credit here. He's not saying, I'm the greatest. You know, I'm the one who laid the foundation. Everybody else is adding to what I've done. No, he's saying, listen, it is all by God's grace. All by his grace that I laid the foundation, preaching Christ that you were saved. The church has begun. And for 18 months, giving sound doctrine, it was all by the grace of God. Can we hear amen to that? Paul says, according to the grace of God, given to me like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and then what does he say? Someone else is building upon it. You know, Paul was not in Corinth forever, right? As we look at the Bible, in case of the Corinth, who was the next guy in line after Paul? It was Apollos. And if you look at Apollos, what Bible had to say about Apollos in 1824, Apollos was what? A powerful and eloquent speaker in the scriptures. Can you imagine what that looks like? I don't know. But a man who had built upon the foundation Paul laid in Corinth. So he continued the work of the ministry. Now remember, Paul came first to Corinth with the gospel as the sower with the seed. Apollos, as we saw last week's sermon, came to water it. Paul laid the foundation. Apollos and others came and built upon what was already laid. As we look on, look at Acts chapter 19. There's someone else, Aquila, Priscilla and Aquila. Look at what does the Bible say? They were able to articulate the gospel even better. Wow. Isn't that amazing? Gifted preachers and speakers in the Bible. And friends, Apollos was followed by others. And all believers, not just Paul, all the believers at Corinth were building up the church together. Can we say all together? One, two, three. All. All together. Which is why Paul says, let each one take care how he builds upon it. Let every person take care how he builds upon it. Paul is saying, I started the work by the grace of God. I laid the foundation. Everybody else has been adding to that. So be very careful how you add to that. You know, for many of us here in this room, some of us might be new to the church, but if you are here today, worshiping right here in this building, Jubilee Bible Church, what is today? Sunday, April 21st, 2024. Those of you may not know, but this church is actually the result of a merge. Back in 2018, this building wasn't always called Jubilee Bible Church. It used to be called Medina Baptist Church. That was one of the churches that had merged together. And Medina Baptist, I believe, started around the 1950s. And was anybody present when Medina Baptist started? Do we have any hands here? Anybody present? Oh, Karen, Wally. Oh, my goodness. Wow. We have some people. When this building had actually started back in the 1950s, the very first person that laid the foundation, actually, Karen, I think you were here when they laid the cornerstone for the building. Yeah. The very first pastor that laid the foundation on this building was Pastor Don Hammond. You can find his painting hanging in the North Conference room right over here. But he was the very first pastor that laid the foundation. And then as the Bible says, there were other pastors that came after him that built upon it. Well, who are some of these pastors? Well, I had to do a little history and look them up. So we have Pastor Don Hammond, and then Pastor James Higgs built upon it. And then Pastor Dennis Norris, a little formatting issue there, built upon it. And then Pastor Walt Peacock built upon it. And then Pastor Dave Peterson built upon it. And then Pastor Craig Jarvis built upon it. And then intern pastor Dr. V, he's sitting right over there. I just see him in the corner of my eye, and Sue. And we honor men who have served their church. Guys, can we give a hand? We're so grateful that you're here. But Pastor Mike Van Lanningham built upon it. And then who is building after Pastor Mike? Oh, yes, South Asian sensation, Pastor Sam Epen. Yes, is now building upon it. You know, the church that had merged with Medina Baptist, the church that merged was called Jubilee Church, which was formerly known as Jubilee Chapel, which was formerly known as Hanmi English Ministry. And that's the church that I was from. I was born and raised, met the Lord, and was serving there as a pastor as well. And this is a little history of how that started. Back in the 90s, the very first pastor that laid the foundation is Dr. Peter Cha. He is actually one of my mentors, most influential seminary professor when I was at Trinity. Really appreciated his wisdom and love and care and counsel for me. And then after Dr. Peter Cha laid the foundation as one of the very first pastors, then came Pastor Grayson Van Camp. She was the woman who actually shared the gospel and led me to Christ. After Pastor Grayson came missionary Sarah Stone, who's in Turkey right now, or Georgia. And then after her came Pastor Bob King, and then Pastor Raymond Song, who then built upon it. And then who came after Pastor Raymond? Again, South Asian sensation, Pastor Sam Epen. God, I love him. I want to pull his leg because he gives me a hard time during the week. So this is my time to roast him, right? All right, so Pastor Sam, look at that. I purposely made the face really big so you can look at the contours of his face. But we are so grateful for Pastor Sam. And why do I show you this? I show you this because, friends, look up here. The work of building continues for years to come until the Lord Jesus returns. Now, some people read this passage and they're like, you know, Pastor Michael, this looks like it's just talking about evangelists and church planters and teachers. But friends, Paul, let's not look at Pastor Sam anymore. Let's move on. All right. Paul is addressing, look at verse 10 and even in verse 13, each one, every believer has a work to do. Can we hear amen to that? Amen. And this is the wonderful, so wonderful to see that all these people building upon the foundation that's been laid, and that's exactly what Paul is speaking of here. Can we hear amen? As we look at verse 11, for no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Wow. What is the foundation that Paul has laid? Is it our ethics? Is it tradition? Is it church culture? Friends, what is the foundation of Jesus Christ? Let's say it all together real loud. One, two, three. Jesus Christ. Let's try it again. One, two, three. A little louder. One, two, three. A little louder. One, two, three. The foundation is Christ. The foundation is the Word of God. The Gospels, the Epistles, the entire Bible. It is all Christ, and you cannot build on any other foundation than Jesus Christ. You know, some people are trying to build their lives on morality or ethics or good deeds and good works. But friends, the only foundation that yields a transformed life, and we have many testimonies that can share that in this room, is Jesus Christ. If that foundation goes, everything else falls. That's what's happening in our world today, in the church, trying to build itself without the true foundation of Christ. And people are trying to build a meaningful life on something other than Christ. And they find it impossible. Why? Because nothing in this world could ever satisfy. Nothing could ever hold water but Christ alone. Nothing. In Acts chapter 4, you'll remember Peter was taken into the Sanhedrin because they didn't like the message he was preaching about the resurrection of Christ. And it got the Sadducees all bent out of shape. They were sad. You see? We're moving on, all right? And God had healed this paralyzed man through Peter and John, and they went to the temple, and then there's this guy begging for alms, and what does Peter say to this guy who's paralyzed? He says, I don't have silver, I don't have gold, but what I do have, I give you in the name of Jesus. Rise up and walk. And he's healed. He's screaming his head off, he's rejoicing, he's praising. And what does verse 10 tell us? They brought Peter and John before the council, and Peter says, let it be known to you and all the people that by the name of Christ, whom you crucified, whom God raised, by him, this man is now standing before you, and he is healed. Here it is, verse 11. This Jesus is what? The stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become what? The cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven among which we must be saved. What is Peter saying? You know what Peter's saying? Peter's saying, listen, all of you, try to substitute Jewish ethics, the Old Testament, your tradition, your law, your offerings, your rules. You rejected the true foundation, which is Christ, but in spite of that, Jesus has come, and he's still become the cornerstone. Can we hear amen? And he says, there can be no salvation, no other name but in Christ alone. And that got them very upset. He's the foundation. If you look at Matthew 16, Jesus said to the disciples, who do you think I am? They're like, well, some people say you're Elijah, some people say you're Jeremiah, some people say you're a prophet. He says, who do you guys think I am? And Peter says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And what does Jesus say? On that confession, I will build my church. And that's the foundation, the identity of Christ, the truth of Christ. He is the only foundation. Friends, there can be no life. There can be no church, no nation, no home, no family, no marriage. No nothing built with lasting value unless it is built on Christ and Christ alone. And we see that so clearly from the scriptures. Amen? As we go to the second point, don't worry. The first one was the longest. Second, third, fourth, really fast. I know, some of you looking at the clock. I am too. Second point is build with the best materials. Build with the best materials. Look at verse 12 and 13. Paul says, now if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. Again, speaking to a Christian audience, right? The foundation's been laid on top of the foundation. Now, question, what material are you going to use to start building? And here we see there are many materials we can use. Some are expensive, some are cheap, some are easily consumed by fire, some will endure the fire, and verse 12 gives them to us in descending value. What are the six building materials that we can use? Gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, and straw. All of these materials can be used, but Paul makes it clear in verse 13 that in much the same way a refiner passes precious metals through fire, our work and what we've built our Christian lives upon will be passed through the heat of God's righteous judgment. The foundation is not going to be touched, but the work that you and I have done all of our lives will either burn up in smoke or it will endure the fire. So the question is, what materials will you choose? What materials will you choose to build your life as a believer? You know, when you read this, there's an implication here. The implication is this, that all Christians and all churches will not end up being the same on Judgment Day. Do you see that? There will be some gold Christians. There will be some straw Christians. There will be some silver believers. There will be some hay believers. There will be some gold churches. There will be some wooden churches. But listen, they're all going to be saved because the foundation is rock solid, but all their efforts and work will either last for eternity with reward or it'll be burned up. As believers in Christ, you and I have no limit to how much we can spend on materials because we've been given the same Spirit of God. There's no limit. So what materials will you and I choose to build our lives? as we look at the scripture, three areas of life that we are building into with these materials. Three areas. What are some areas we're building into using gold or silver, precious stones? Well, we're building into our motives. Building into our motives. 1 Corinthians 4, 5 says, God's going to make the hidden things of the heart manifest. So what does that mean? God is going to judge our motives. The very motives to why we do what we do each day. Some of our motives are gold. Some of them are silver. Some of them are hay. Some of them are straw. When you and I choose to do something totally, fully for the glory of God, what is that? That's gold. And God knows your motive. But when you do something for the reward and the applause of others, what is that? Straw? Could be hay. Maybe wood. If you read your Bible more, I don't know. So the judgment of Christians includes what? Our motives. Not just our motives, but I would say our conduct as well. We're building into our conduct. Look at 2 Corinthians 5:10 says, we'll be judged for the things done in the body. These are things you and I do with our hands and feet. Third area is what? Our ministry and spiritual gifts. As it says in 1 Peter 4, that all believers have been given spiritual gifts, and we're commanded to use those gifts to serve one another, build up the body of Christ. Can we hear amen to that? So friends, on that day, capital D, the day of the Lord, when Christ returns, God is going to judge your motives. He's going to judge your conduct. He's going to judge your ministry and see what kind of building have you been building? What materials have you been using? And will it last in the fire? But what about the church? We're talking about us, but what about the church? Well, I made a short list of 7 points of what building with the right materials and wrong. It is not an exhaustive list. Just as I look at Corinthians, these are some things talked about. 7 signs that you're building with the wrong material. How do you know a church is being built with the wrong materials, like wood, hay, straw? Well, scripture is not taken seriously. Church is not using God's word, then they're using human wisdom, which is going to go up in flames, right? Sin is redefined to be culturally acceptable, right? Church starts to look very similar to the culture around us. The gospel is preached, but not lived out. Repentance is minimized. Church division is tolerated. Sexual immorality is tolerated. Ministry is dependent on strategy and not prayer. 7 signs. I'm sure there's more. That a church is being built using the wrong materials. But what about using the right materials? Well, evangelism and discipleship are at the forefront. Next generation is considered in all initiatives. Relational reconciliation is pursued. If there is people in the church that we know that have issues with each other, we don't ignore it. We bring them together. We're like, hey, this is not right. This hinders the fellowship. This hinders the church. Let's come together. Let's pray. Let's reconcile. Sin is not tolerated but addressed. Everyone is equipped to use their gift. People model generosity. And I think the 7th one is what convicts me the most. Neighbors would be sad if the church disappeared. If this building was shut down, everybody on Foster Avenue, all of those homes be like, man, I'm so sad that that church closed. Or would anybody notice that the church is gone? Friends, let's build with the right materials. Can we hear amen to that? Can we hear amen to that? Amen. 3rd point. See, I told you we're going faster. Faster. Building toward final inspection. What is the final inspection? Verse 14, if the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he's going to suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as through fire. Look at the NLT version. I like the NLT. It says, if the work survives, then the builder is going to receive a reward. But if the work is burned up, the builder will suffer great loss. I love this part. Look at this. The builder will be saved, but like someone barely escaping through a wall of flames. Like you just made it. You see, once the building is up, there's going to be inspection. That's true of any building you build. And verse 13 tells us that everyone's work is going to be displayed and put through the fiery test of God's righteousness. And the question is, what's next? What is God going to do after that final inspection? You know, you and I would think, well, maybe there's punishment or condemnation, but the Bible says what? After the fiery test, there will be rewards. Can we turn to our neighbor and say, let's look forward to rewards? God is going to reward you as a believer, the fruit of all your hard work and labor. And again, every man shall have what? Praise from God. Everyone will have praise. Whatever's left in your building, God will reward. Now, I want to be very clear. Very clear. Paul is not talking about salvation here. Because once again, he's addressing believers. Paul is saying that a Christian's works might be burned up, but not the believer. The believer will be saved. Do you see that in verse 15? It says what? They will make it, but barely, by the skin of their teeth. They're going to suffer a lot of loss, but not the loss of salvation. Let me say it again. They will suffer a lot of loss, but not the loss of salvation. Your salvation is secure as a believer in Christ. But all that building, everything that you poured your life into is going to come down, it's going to burn up, you're going to lose it all. So friends, let's build wisely. Let's build well. Amen? Apostle John, 2 John 8 says what? Watch yourself so you may not lose what we've worked hard for, but may win a full reward. Brothers and sisters, let's build well. Whenever Pastor Sam comes up and he's preaching the gospel and you receive it with joy, that's gold. You go home, you say, God, I want to practice the word. That's gold. You share that truth with somebody else. That's gold. Your daily conduct, your service, love. Friends, let's build with the right materials for the final inspection. Amen? As we close, last point. We're going fast. Almost done. Building God's dwelling place. How do we close here? Verse 16, 17 says what? Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. For God's temple is holy and you are that temple. Friends, isn't that a glorious truth? If you're a believer in Christ, if you surrendered your life to Jesus and declare him to be the Lord and Savior, King, Master of your life, the Bible says what? You and I are the dwelling place. We are literally the temple of God's Spirit. Can we hear amen to that? That is a powerful truth. If you and I only knew how much power we have, spiritual power, because the living God dwells in us. I believe it was D.L. Moody, I think, who said, everybody has the Holy Spirit, but does the Holy Spirit have you? Have you yielded every part of your life to the Spirit? Paul teaches later in context of sexual immorality, 1 Corinthians, same concept. Do you not know that your body is what? A temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God. You are not your own, for you are bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. Can we hear amen? That means you and I, we can't do whatever we want with our bodies. It's never my body, my choice. No, it belongs to the Lord. God dwells in our bodies. We can't do whatever we want. God's temple is sacred, holy. As you look at the Old Testament, if you look at the Old Testament, what happened to a person who went into the Holy of Holies just because they wanted to walk in? What did they pay with? They pay with their life. Even the priest who went in once a year, he had to go through all these protocols. It was incredible. He had a bell tied to his waist so that they can hear the jingle, make sure he's not dead as he's on his way into the Holy Holies. Jewish tradition says they had a rope tied to their ankle. In case he does fall, somebody can pull him out. Friends, you and I are this holy, glorious temple of God in which the Spirit dwells. We, Paul says, you are that temple. But you know, it says there are some people in this world that are trying to destroy what God is doing. Last verse says what? If anyone destroys God's temple, heed this warning. God will destroy him. For God's temple is holy, and you are that temple. Who is Paul talking about? He's talking about people who want to destroy the work of God. Somebody who comes along and tries to undo what God has done. Somebody who comes along and tries to hinder the work of the church. Somebody who comes along and tries to remove the foundation of Christ, even within the church, even inside the church. Somebody who seeks to sow division. somebody who stumbles weaker believers to sin. Paul is warning the Corinthian church, this person is setting themselves up to be destroyed by God. Why? Because you and I are the precious, beloved, holy dwelling place of the living God. Can we hear amen to that? So friends, as we close, there's coming a day of rewards. It's going to be as soon as Jesus comes, so there won't be any time for making adjustments. What will happen when that time comes? As believers in Christ, what are you building, and will it stand the test of fire? Friends, let's build our lives. Let's build our families, our ministries, our church on the rock solid foundation of Christ and the materials that will last for eternity. Can we hear amen to that? Some of you here this morning as we go into prayer are not believers. Some of you do not know who the Lord is or don't have a relationship with God. If you're not a believer, if you're not sure what's going to happen to your life after your life is said and done on this earth, friends, can I share with you this morning the good news? The good news is that God knows you and God sees you. And God gave his one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer and die to take your sins and my sins away. And he says, if you will bend your knee, if you will bow and surrender your life to Christ and repent of your sin, you will receive a life and go on a journey of adventure with faith like nothing you've ever experienced before. But you must surrender your life to Christ. If that's you this morning, I pray that you will be able to make that decision. We would love to pray with you. We would love to pray with you and get you connected. Amen? Let's bow together in prayer as you respond to God's word. Let's pray. Help us to build on the true foundation of Christ. Help us to build with the best materials, with gold, with silver, precious stones. Help us to build knowing that there is going to be an inspection coming. And I pray that what we are building is going to last through the fire for the great rewards that are in store as we give our best in this life. Help us to build a dwelling place as you dwell in our hearts. For those here that do not know the Lord, God is here. He is closer than you think, closer than you know. Perhaps you were here brought by a friend, or you're just visiting, or you're just swinging by town. If you have not made a decision to surrender your life to Christ, as a church, we love you, we encourage you, we testify that you will not regret making this decision of bending your knee and saying, God, I will not run away anymore. I've tried everything. I've lived for the weekends. Parties are great, but it leaves me empty on Monday morning. And it's the same routine again and again and again and again. God, I've tried it all. I've partied. I've slept around. I've done everything, Lord. But still, I'm empty. I'm just not full. Like, it's not enough. Friends, let me tell you the answer. The answer is Christ. The answer is Jesus. He is the remedy to what you've been looking for. He's the one you've been searching for. He's the one that wants to come into your heart now. We're going to sing a song in a few moments, but if that is you here this morning and you want to make a decision for Christ, our elders are here, and I'm going to ask our elders actually to come to the front. But we would love to pray with you. We'd love to pray with you. And so we have our elders standing in the front. Just come to the front. We'd love to pray with you if you want to make that decision and resolve to no longer live your life for yourself, but to say, God, I surrender. God, I want you to come into my life. I'm broken. I'm empty. I'm dry. I need you. So we're going to sing a song in a few moments, but if you'd like to make that decision, we invite you to come to the front. We'd love to pray with you. And you might be asking, well, why do I have to come to the front? Why can't I just make that decision? Yeah, you can make the decision in your chair, but the Bible does say, Jesus says, he who testifies about me before others, Jesus says, I will testify you before my Father. And so if you make that decision, may it be a decision that you're not ashamed of, a decision that you will make before friends or family that you're here with. Okay, so a few moments to pray, and then we will sing a song. But for the rest of us who are believers, let's pray. God, help us to build on the right foundation. Help us to build with gold and silver, precious stones. God, help me. Help me to think of that final inspection coming one day when I go through the fiery test of your righteousness. God, I look forward to the day where I will receive rewards. A few moments to pray, and then we'll close together. Again, if you'd like to make a decision for Christ, we'd love to pray with you. Please come, join us in front so we can pray for you. Few moments to pray.
Above every other.
was the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
Solid foundation of Christ, using the best of materials, looking forward to the day of inspection, God, where we will receive a reward from you. Father, we praise you for the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, who has died, taken our sins as far as the east is from the west, O Lord. We praise you for this goodness that pursues us all the days of our lives. And for anyone here that does not know you, still we pray that you would draw them to you, God, that in the stillness of their home, in their room, they would get on their knees to give their life to you, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you for who you are, Lord. Help us to build. As a church, help us to build. As we pray and lift all these things in our hearts, we pray that the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the everlasting, unconditional love of God our Father and the empowering presence, the koinonia of the Holy Spirit would be with every one of us now and forevermore. And God's people say, amen. Amen, amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you so much for joining us. You are loved. If you would like to talk to any of the elders, they're still up here, about how to start an exciting relationship with Christ. And join us for our brother Mark Smith's ordination ceremony and awesome party this afternoon. Thank you, everybody. You are loved. Have a wonderful day.